first give us your name.
Okay, I'm sorry. Clant, C-L-A-N-T, last name, S-E-A-Y, pronounced C, from Mississippi. Mr. Griffiths is the chairman. He's a good citizen, does a good job. There was a question about campaign contribution. That's normal in these communities. That's what Americans do. They get behind candidates that they believe in. Mr. Griffiths' daddy was put in play. He called me the next morning and clarified all that. So we're not here to fuss about anything regarding Mr. Griffiths or his daddy, either one. I wanted to preface before we go start with that, because that doesn't need to be part of what we're doing here.
But it was despicable. It was something that, it was one of the most despicable emails I've ever seen in my life.
And I
have known him for almost 35 years. You, sir, I don't think know him, but you're talking about a fine young man, and you, by innuendo, you impugn his reputation and his character, and I thought it was despicable.
You're Mr. Wilkes.
Yes,
Mr. Wilkes.
I agree with that.
Come on. One more. Mrs. Milligan put Mr. Griffith's father in play by listing him on the tax return from the annual report.
Can I stop for a second, Clint? Yeah. You're running out of time.
We're not going to
get on trial about what the
well,
these issues. But
I would
ask you to concentrate on your issue and not
okay.
these issues.
Well, we got several citizens that would like to be heard here today.
Everyone
will get their time.
You can get 3 minutes.
And the first lady is behind me, and she wants to play a video for her 3 minutes.
That'll be great.
Is that okay?
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Can I make a comment though before we call up the next person? Obviously, there's a few people here regarding the horse issue and the horse show and the funding. When the question was deferred to me, because you requested to be on the agenda, the horse show was heard. We probably spent 30 minutes in our January meeting, less than 60 days ago, and the horse show was on the agenda. It was vetted in detail, and I'm not sure why you did not present any of your concerns. I applaud your passion and enthusiasm, but that was really the time to address any concerns. It was an agenda item. It was a noticed meeting. And when the item was deferred to me, that's why I said it was not appropriate to add this to agenda when it was just on the agenda in January. I just wanted to make that statement.
But I'd like to respond, please, with permission of the chair.
I'm just warning you. We have a lot of people to speak, and you're
I totally understand
down.
That.
I was just making a statement.
Your meeting was January the 12th. The first notice I had of this, I provided Mr. Rowe with notice. I've sent numerous emails to Mr. Rowe. He's a competent professional. I've asked for discussions starting January 29th about this particular issue. You had another meeting coming back on February the 9th. It could have been taken up then. Mr. Rowe never offered me any type of conference call. We had Mrs. Bippin, president of a national organization, wanting to participate. It's all a present. And we should have had a conference call, and we should have discussed the issue, and then you would have known that we wouldn't be here today at this late date. But nevertheless, we are here because you've been gracious enough to extend us the opportunity, and we appreciate it. And so without, I know your time is valuable. I've heard important business discussed here this morning, so we need to go forward with what we're doing. But that's why we're here today.
Well, I do have just a question.
Yes,
for you.
Yes.
Why weren't you at the meeting in January when it was on the agenda?
Sir,
these are public meetings. The agendas are posted 48 hours in advance, minimally 48 hours in advance by law. And it seemed like if that was the agenda item, that would have been the appropriate time for you to present any facts you had for or against the event that was in question.
Believe me, sir, I don't live here, but if I had noticed,
okay.
We would have been.
I just had to ask the question.
Well, that's a fair question. And Mrs. Milligan went to the city, Mr. Russell, late to the parade. They had an agreement with the city to have the show. Then she came to you guys for the money on January 12th, okay? You noticed it? We didn't know that she was asking for the money, all right? We had trust. We would have been here to tell you what this was all about. Nevertheless, we presented a lot of facts since that time. You now know what you know on January 12th, you would have been able to make an informed decision.
Which we didn't know at that time.
Sir?
Which we did not know at that time.
I fully understand that.
You're talking about a lot of folks who are animal lovers, and that would have made a big impact on us if somebody had been here.
Correct. And Mr. Rowe, to his credit, when I asked him, I said, has the money been paid? He said, no, it has not. That's what we're standing here in front of you. We understand we're not on the agenda. We're having probably what we would have done January 12th if we had been. So, I know your time is valuable.
I just have one other comment.
Oh, yes, sir.
based on the hundreds and hundreds of emails that I've received, you guys are obviously very passionate about what you do, and I applaud that. But all the information that has been sent via emails, published in the newspaper, everything that has come to light in the last month or 30 days, obviously has been going on for up to 5-6 years based on what I've read in some of the emails. So again, I ask, why was that not presented at the January meeting? It wasn't like this stuff, you had these revelations in the last 6 weeks. It's been out there, you've done your research, you've got videos that go back 2 and 3 and 4 years in pictures, and why wasn't that information shared? Because we couldn't make that decision when that information was not presented.
Mr. Sale has a thing called ask and answer in his profession. Sir, we had no knowledge she was going to come ask you for $25,000. Yeah, you're looking at paying $25,000 to get $1 million worth of bad publicity. That's what all these emails are about. That's why we're in front of you this morning. But absolutely, if we had knowledge she was going to come with a $25,000, of course we would have been here. And I apologize that we didn't know, but we didn't know. I'm up in Middle Tennessee at this point in Mississippi, and we just didn't know. I have my close friends in Mississippi say everybody 20 miles inland is planning a conspiracy against them. Okay. And maybe that's how it is here. But we're not. We just had knowledge. And once we had knowledge, Mr. Rowe can tell you, we contacted him immediately. Change.org started. There's over 9,000 signatures. But we let him know. We're starting it. We're not trying to hurt you. We're bringing attention to this. And I didn't find out about the $25,000 until I got here and appeared before the city on February 11th. Then the next day, I found out about the $25,000. And it's been going ever since. Yes, Mr. Walson.
Yes, let me say that we're not horse people. We really appreciate what you do. We all love animals, you know, but we didn't know all of the stuff that we know now before we all voted on in January, you know. So if we didn't have, we might not have approved it. But we approved it, you know. You approve something for them to go ahead, and I don't know how much money they've spent since we approved that, you know. But we're business people, and then you do a budget by the money you get. So I don't know, they've spent a lot of money since then. So it's hard to undo something that's been done.
You ever audit her? You ever know where she spends the money? Has there ever been an accounting where she spends the money?
Mr. Chairman, could we please get to there?
I was going to say, Mr. Sake, if we're really, I know you have a lot of people that like to speak. If you'd like to show the video, I encourage you to do that now.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much. This is on business. This lady here. Diane.
Hi, I'm Diane DuPont, 128
Cottonwood
Circle, Lynn Haven, Florida.
May I turn the
lights
on?
Yes, sir.
And I'm not a horse person. But I would like to utilize my time before you to play this short video. The first time I watched it many years ago, it changed me. Every successive time I've watched it still hurts me to my core. This is not a new cause for me, as I've been trying to stop this horse show here in Panama City for many years. We have thousands of people and a collective voice, and we're speaking to you simultaneously. How could anyone watch this and have any doubt that this cruelty exists? How could one continue to believe it's fabricated by all of those standing before you and countless other advocates all over the world? Please don't tarnish Panama City Beach's image for 2 successive years. Have we not learned from last year's spring break debacle where we made national news? Don't we want to make the news for doing the right thing instead? This board has been entrusted with the reputation of our city. You have the power to help put an end to this. Please do not just step aside and let it happen. Thank you for your time and consideration.
We'll play the video. We have more lights if you need. Thank you. Matthew McConnell. I've had him in the back seat of my car. I know all these folks, okay? He goes to church. He does a lot of good things in life, but this is not good. They become hardened and desensitized to what they do. This is the way they make a living. Respectfully, Miss Milligan is in denial. She sees this as fun and sport. She loves something about this, but she doesn't love horses. Anybody that loves horses does not get into this. Look who you're getting in business with if you give this $25,000. You're getting in business with Jackie McConnell and that bunch of trainers. It's a trainer show. The work takes horses. He's hitting that horse because he's touching that horse not to react when he's inspected. Here's a sheep that has 35% of these horses at their Super Bowl last August were disqualified by the USDA veterinarian for violation of the Horse Protection Act. Now they have more. They had Hoover wrote a book, Masters of Deceit. These people are professional in deceiving, okay? Ms. Milligan is not a bad person, okay? She's an established member of this community. But she's bringing her hobby here, and any institution is bigger than any one person. I've sat here and I've listened to tourism. I've listened to your development. I've listened to Ms. Ordonez, if I come close, present to you about the social media. Put together a video, released it 2 days ago. It's been seen by 80,000 people about this thing right here. You don't want to own this. Cancel the $25,000. Call her in. Explain it to her. This is going to hurt you. You can't go in business with these people on this trainer show, for God's sakes. Yes, I'm passionate, and I understand I'm coming on strong, but I can't help it. It's as right and as wrong as black and white. There's no middle ground on this. The PAST Act, this is what this is. 18 of your 27 Florida congressmen are for abolishing this piglet, which is the show you're having here. They include Ted Yoho, who's extreme right, Alcee Hastings, extreme left.
Mr. Seay, you've extended really your
Well, I want to spend three sentences and I'll be out anyway.
I'm going to give you 30 seconds.
That's fine. The whole country's lined up against this. All of your Florida congressional delegation, your representative Gwen Graham, is against it. It makes no sense. You've been gracious to have me before you. Erasers are put on the end of the pencil to correct mistakes. Have a committee. Go to her. Talk to her. Ms. Oberst, you can't pass this out. Can't pass the buck on this. If you can't get the show canceled, ask her to move it. But you folks don't need to go in business with her. That's the main problem. You can't go in business with the big lick. You're buying $1 million worth of bad publicity. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. I'm available for any questions by anybody.
One question. Isn't that against the law, what we saw? Isn't it against the law?
What's against the law?
What they're doing.
Animal cruelty.
I mean, isn't it
There's a federal regulation. It pertains to when they take the horse to a show. What they're doing at a barn, it may be a Tennessee statute of aggravated animal cruelty. But you have to document it. Extremely hard to prove. Okay? So, your answer is a good question, but it's you have state statutes, and then you have a Horse Protection Act. The violations Ms. Milligan has have to do with the Horse Protection Act. They're tickets. They're citations. It's like you get a speeding ticket. Now, you hadn't gone to court and been proven guilty, and she's innocent until she's proven guilty. But the most egregious thing is in December, she was charged with having a horse that was sore here at this horse show in 2013. I didn't say foreign substance. I said sore, S-O-R-E. Sore, like what you saw those horses trying to move around. And it will be adjudicated at one point. They don't bring those complaints unless it's extremely serious.
So would some, at this show, wherever it is, would somebody in the U.S. government, somebody in that agency, would they show up for that?
Yes, sir. The USDA vets inspect these shows. They come in and enforce the Horse Protection Act. But what I'm saying to you is this is where they inspected their 10-day Super Bowl, and 35% of the horses were disqualified. That's egregious. That's not like 4 or 5%. 35% is bad, and this is USDA vets, okay? They're trained to inspect these horses, and that's why they're trying to abolish it. That's why you got 60% of the United States House of Representatives behind this law publicly, and you also have Senator Nelson from your state and Senator Rubio, who was
who?
Rubio fellow. In essence, you're going against the grain, big time. That's what I'm trying to get through. I mean, it's not going to be good. It's not going to be good. You don't deserve this. You don't deserve it.
Thank you. speak on this issue?
Chairman, I would. My name is Daniel Harmon. I live at 208 Judy Circle, and I'm incorporated in Bay County. I own property here on Panama City Beach, and I do have horses. And my wife and my daughter have participated in the Gulf Coast Charity Horse Show for many, many years. The Horse Protection Act deals with horses, whether they're horse races, in horse racing, whether they're equestrian horses, whether they're polo horses, or whether they're Tennessee walkers, like the ones we have. Each show is required to appoint a qualified individual to inspect the horses before they enter the ring, and the winners in that show are inspected upon leaving. These qualified inspectors are trained and certified under USDA standards. The Gulf Coast Charity Horse Show is compliant with the law. In addition, USDA has its own inspection team that they put on these types of sites, and they can detain any horse they wish to, and have traditionally been here during the 14 years, 15 years that we have been putting on this show, or the show has been being put on. The Horse Protection Act is now more than 40 years old, and it has matured just like technology has matured. I will represent to this committee that USDA now utilizes thermography to detect old injuries in Tennessee walkers. And Tennessee walkers in particular are subject to what they call the scarring rule, which deals with old injuries being detected, not only current sores or anything like that. Because these previously injured horses are tagged, they're using retinal identification now on these horses to make sure that these horses don't re-enter at some other point. Because quite frankly, horses sometimes are difficult to tell apart. So there is absolutely no motivation in a show allowing a horse that has been sore or has been injured in the past to participate. There are specific criminal and civil sanctions for doing so. Because we are a federal statute, we're subject to Federal Whistleblower Act, and anybody who is a disgruntled employee that works at one of these places could come forward. And if this was such a rampant type of activity in today's show world, I think that we would see a lot more of that whistleblower type activity and not a single episode where there may have been one bad apple in the group. These horses are extremely valuable. Some of them are worth tens of thousands of dollars. And to have your horse injured and then shown in one of these competitions and then marked as injured totally ruins the investment in the animals to begin with. So again, there's not a whole lot of motivation for these shows to allow animals who have been injured in the past to participate at this point. The participants in this event come from all over, mostly the South, Kentucky, Tennessee, Alabama, Georgia, Mississippi, the demographic that the TDC generally works with. They spend money while they're here, and the horse show puts heads in beds, as that saying is traditionally looked at. The economic impact has been estimated in excess of $4 million annually for this particular show. Panama City Beach is advertised in a positive light all over the horse country. Ms. Blackman has been an outstanding ambassador for the area. The Panama City Beach Show has a positive impact on the community, both economically and to its image. I'm concerned that there are attempts to tarnish that image. It has been, up to this point in time, a successful event. It has contributed over $700,000 to charities, mostly local. The show's 990, the form filed with the IRS is available for inspection.
Mr. Harmon.
The vet taxes exceed the amount of the contribution that we are being given in this case, and I want to assure you that your money has been and it will continue to be well spent.